Support for WYES is made possible by Mary Lou Kristovich in memory of her husband, William Kristovich.
Peggy Scott Laborde, and welcome to Steppin Out, spotlighting the New Orleans area's arts and entertainment scene. Seated at our table tonight, author Julia Reed, here to discuss her latest book, Julia Reed's South. Welcome. We're so glad you're
here. Thank you, Peggy. I'm always thrilled to be here.
We're delighted. Poppy Tooker, host of the WWNO radio program, Louisiana Eats. Hello, dear.
Hey, Peg.
Hi. Augustin J. Correro. He is the co-artistic director of the Tennessee Williams Theater Company of New Orleans, here to discuss their current production of The Rose Tattoo, and to show us a little bit too, right?
We're very excited about that.
Very good. And we're also thrilled to have Marci Schramm, who is the head of French Quarter Festival, but also she's here to talk about Satchmo Fest. Yay! And Alan Smason will return next week. But first up, Marci, yes.
Thank you for having us back.
Sure, sure. So, lots of exciting things, celebrating Mr. Armstrong's birthday.
It is our
next week,
16th anniversary, yes. He was born August 4th, and so we always throw this party the weekend of his birth. And it's a uniquely New Orleans celebration. It's the only Armstrong Festival in the world, which is a great claim to fame. This year, we're picking it up and moving it into Jackson Square, which is a huge move for us. Also partnering with Le Petit Theater and the Louisiana State Museum. So we'll have some beautiful indoor venues with lots of air conditioning, along with great live music in Jackson Square.
What I really like is, in addition to, obviously, music, free music, but you're also celebrating his life in the symposium. Mm-hmm. And so you've got a lot of these panels with folks coming in, experts, to talk about mm-hmm. his life as well.
And the symposium's amazing. It's just as important as these three stages of music are these scholars we bring in from all over the world. This year we've got some new talent and some returning faces that we haven't had in years. We've got Gary Giddens opening the festival.
Yeah, he's big.
He is phenomenal. I could listen to him for days. He's so fascinating. And he's got a new book out, a new Bing Crosby book. And as a lot of people know, Bing and Louis were great friends, and he's going to focus a lot on that relationship. And also we'll have his books available at Fest. And then very excited that Catherine Russell is with us. She's a Grammy-winning vocalist from New York. Her dad was Louis Russell, who was Louis Armstrong's band leader.
Absolutely.
So all these great ties, all this living history.
From the 20s and 30s.
Also new for Festival this year is Victor Goines, who's a native son, has been in New York for years playing with Wynton Marsalis and the Jazz Orchestra, but we'll have Victor in the symposium and on stage. So lots of new and fresh things, as well as people like Michael Cogswell from the Armstrong House and all these favorites that come back every year.
And some show and tell, a beautiful poster this year.
Thank you.
And we'll show that in just a moment. And mm-hmm. who's the artist?
Terry Mark Sr. from the Ninth Ward.
But mm-hmm. you also have, ooh, I'm a fan of fans. So I've got to show this great, this is the ultimate souvenir in addition to that poster as well. But this will be available.
Absolutely,
for sale
yes.
too. Mm-hmm. One other thing that I wanted to mention is that you pay homage to folks who contribute mightily to the jazz scene. Mm-hmm. I see our pal, Dr. Bruce Rayburn of the Tulane mm-hmm. Jazz Archives being honored. That's mm-hmm. a wonderful thing.
It's a new thing we started last year called the Spirit of Satch Awards, and we're honoring people who keep traditional jazz alive, people who make a significant difference in the cultural scene in New Orleans as it relates to traditional jazz music and Louis Armstrong. So, as you mentioned, Bruce Rayburn, who's a dear friend of the festival, also in the symposium this year. WWOZ is getting a Culture Bearer Award, the Zulu Social Aid and Pleasure Club.
Of course, Louis Armstrong was Zulu.
He was King of Zulu in 1949.
Yeah.
And a few others, just really people, Basin Street Records, because they are such a great local record label that, you know, highlights people like Dr. Michael White and Kermit Ruffins and all the great trad jazz artists.
And if somebody wants to help and have fun, there's a kickoff party?
There is. Thursday night at Le Petit Theater, Tom McDermott and friends playing Satch.
We just had him on a few weeks
ago. Amazing.
He's
so amazing. Uh-huh. He's going to have a lot of fun. He's playing Louis Armstrong from the 1920s through the 1960s. He's got a theme. And then we're going to second line over to the Royal Orleans, and they throw a beautiful party for us. And it's a chance to really mix and mingle with all those symposiums podium presenters and special guests.
I like the fact you also have a Pulitzer Prize panel. That's
unusual.
We do.
The Louisiana Endowment for the Humanities are great partners of ours, and we work with them to produce the program book. And this year, they also brought in the Pulitzer Prize. It's the 100-year anniversary, and we have a special panel on Sunday, and it's going to be about Louis Armstrong and Wynton Marsalis. And, you know, Wynton was a Pulitzer winner, so focusing on how New Orleans influenced both men and their music.
Very good. Well, congratulations.
Thank you.
For all your good stuff. And of course, we should remind everybody, if they don't know, that not only does French Quarter Festival, Inc. produce the French Quarter Festival, but also Christmas at Christmas time, too.
We do. Christmas New Orleans style will be 34 this year. It's been around for a while. And it's for us, it's a labor of love. We enjoy doing it because it's to really showcase all the amazing holiday things there are to do in New Orleans.
Yeah, and so we, for more details, mm-hmm. French Quarter,
FQFI.org, yes.
FQFI.
Yeah, and I would be remiss if I didn't mention, we are Satchmo Summer Fest presented by Chevron. They're an amazing partner, and they help us produce everything we do.
Okay, well, great. Thank you so
much.
And the last time you were so kind to be at our table, you had a book. You've been busy. You've got another new book.
I have.
And this one, you were saying, even though it was hard work, you kept having to give parties.
Yeah, well, it was a good problem to have. I mean, this is the first book I've ever done with actual, I mean, I've written about food a lot. In the last book I was here doing, But Mom Always Put Buck in Her Sangria, was a collection of essays and recipes. This is a little scarier because we took, actually, Paul Costello is a great friend of mine and a terrific photographer. He works all over the world, but he lives in the Garden District with his wife, Sarah, and we had a blast photographing this. It was kind of like a road trip with parties. I mean,
and it was in the South, you know, in the fields sometimes,
right?
In people's houses.
Yeah, I mean, as I was
great photos,
telling
yeah.
you earlier, you know, and I didn't want to just do a cookbook and, you know, in a studio and do the food and sort of just to have it be kind of sterile. I really wanted to show, because I'm not a professional chef, I'm not that kind of cook. I mean, I cook to have fun and to throw parties and entertain people, so that was kind of what I wanted to bring to the project. And so I realize, I mean, I don't own the South. What Julia Reed South means means that these are places that I either actually live in, or they're my spiritual homes. That, you know, sort of makes sense. Like one of the chapters is a New Orleans cold Creole supper, and we shot that at my pal Peter Pate's magical house in the French Quarter in his courtyard.
You're good bud.
Yeah,
good buddy.
I love this picture. Is this in your house?
That is my
dog?
House with my dog,
wow.
Who's always he's a camera hog and a food hog, so he makes lots of appearances. That's a Christmas party.
Well, what I like though, Julia, so much too, is that you don't have to. You're not snooty.
You've got some
cooking in here, but some of it's not so fancy. And I also like the fact that you recommend, in terms of local fried chicken, McCarty's.
Yeah, I know. I mean, listen, I'm a big fan of McCarty's. I'm not above a big old box of Rouse's fried chicken.
And Popeye's too.
When I lived in New Orleans, I mean, when I lived in Manhattan, I used to go down and get a bucket of Popeye's and fix like gumbo and stuff, and people would go crazy. I mean, I can fry chicken and I can make biscuits, but I'm not going to do that for 40 people, which is what one of those parties was for. So I tell people, like, man, go. I mean, like, you know, when I was growing up, you would know, like, which lady was at the Piggly Wiggly that afternoon or at the gas station who cooked the best fried chicken, and we go there. And I'm a huge fan of frozen Marshall's biscuits, because I'm not going to be making biscuits for a bunch of people either.
Well, speaking of frozen, you have a recipe for frozen whiskey sours?
I do indeed.
Whoa. I like that.
This time of year, I want everything frozen. That is from my good friend Elizabeth Cortez. Elizabeth has never seen a cocktail that she didn't want to make frozen, so that was a big hit one Christmas. It was a cocktail party, and we ended up, like, realizing that there were children in the house. I think we ordered pizza at about midnight for them. Beware the frozen whiskey sour.
Well, in your book, you talk about being very much inspired by the late, great Lee Bailey, who is a son of Louisiana, but spent a lot of time in New York.
In Manhattan,
and did a lot of great style books and food books, too. So he was an inspiration?
He was a total inspiration. I think when I was in college, I got his first book came out, Country Weekends. And it's a gorgeous book, but also laid back. I mean, one of my favorite pictures in the book is of like a carrot custard with a crack down the middle, because I think he dropped it or something. I don't know. But That's his way of entertaining. I just adored, and I was terrified hostess when I was in Washington, when I was in college, because I was working at Newsweek, and I was the kid, right? So I would have all my much more accomplished colleagues over for dinner, and I'd be completely freaking out, and I'd be trying to get on the phone with my mother, and this is when long distance cost a lot of money, and I'd be running through these really uptight menus, Nouvelle cuisine, it just was a thing, and she finally said, "Why don't you just make something that tastes good?" And about the same time, Lee Bailey was doing the same thing and making grit souffles and stuff like that for the Yankees in Manhattan and in the Hamptons where he lived. And so I thought, okay, I'm just going to go back to my roots like Lee did and like what my mother, who's very smart and a great entertainer, told me to do.
And speaking of roots, though, of course, you are these days an Orleanian, but you and Augustin, I'm finding out, are both from Greenville, Mississippi originally.
We're fellow Mississippi Deltons, yeah.
Yeah, so the Delta.
And that's a place that looms large, and I write about it a lot in the book, and we shot a great many chapters there. It's still where I call home, but it's it's a place where you had to learn to entertain yourself pretty early on. I mean, we have a few really famous restaurants like Doe's Eat Place, but their menu is spaghetti, hot tamales, and steaks and fried shrimp. I mean, you can't eat that every night of the week. I mean, I try when I'm home to do that, but so everybody had to become like a cook and entertainer . You know, when we run out of things to do, we come up with new things to do. Like, there's a sandbar picnic in the book.
Why not take
a boat to the middle of the Mississippi River and have a picnic?
Now, I know you're a busy bee. In addition to this, you've been traveling all around with book signings, but you also write for Garden and Gun and El Decor, too.
Garden and Gun has been a real joy to me because it's a beautiful magazine. They were just here this week doing a fashion shoot. They have just incredible quality photographers working for them and great writers. Roy Blunt, who now lives in the French Quarter half the year, he and his wife Joan Griswold, who's a brilliant artist, live here now about 6 or 7 months a year. And Roy writes a back page column, and I write a column in the middle called The High and the Low, which is kind of what this cookbook is about, mixing high and low fun.
So you're traveling around these days. I know you really haven't been in New Orleans
I've been having the happy problem of having people give me book signings and more parties. So
very good.
I've eaten a lot of cheese dreams, which are these incredibly rich hors d'oeuvres in the book. Everybody keeps thinking, well, we'll make some food from your book. I'm going to die before this.
Do you have a favorite recipe?
Oh, God. In the book, I mean, that's a toughie. I wish I had thought about that. You would think I might. I love, there's a shrimp dish in there called shrimp malacca. I mean, Poppy will appreciate this. I have a huge cookbook collection, and I've saved, like, all these old House and Gardens back when they used to have an amazing food section, and House and Garden didn't exist anymore, but... Maurice Morbetti, who was like this sort of chef in New York around the time, or like a sort of cookbook writer and chef around the time Julia Child was huge, had this recipe, and it's basically shrimp reel with curry in it, but it is delicious,
okay.
And it's in there.
Well, great. Well, thanks again.
It's a good summer thing.
And congratulations.
Thank you so much.
And speaking of Julia, New Orleans Magazine quiz queen, Julia Street, has a question for us. Last time, Rick Leslie told us who were nominated for president and vice president at the only national political party convention that was held in New Orleans, George H. Bush and Dan Quayle. Now, tonight's question. Name three Louisiana parishes named after United States presidents. Email your answers to steppinout@wyes.org. Our prizes. Tonight we have a year subscription to Louisiana Life magazine. And we also have a dish towel with the message, "Bagels can't be choosers," from our friends at wearablevegetables.com. And thanks to our friends at Pelican Publishing, we have two copies of the book, Chocolate Desserts for two here. Okay, by Biff Schaefer, to die for. Excuse me, let me put my glasses on. Chocolate Desserts to Die For. We also have a pair of free admission passes to either the Audubon Zoo, Aquarium of the Americas, or Butterfly Garden and Insectarium. You can visit WYES.org for our online calendar to see our lineup of events. You can also link to our WYES YouTube channel to visit our program. Now, to Poppy.
Well, all I can say is, doo doo, doo doo. happens to be that shark time of year. And Pizza Nola is doing the craziest thing on Sunday. They're hosting Shark Fest from 1 o'clock in the afternoon till 9 o'clock in the evening. You can, it's a huge, all sorts of entertaining thing. You can go meet Carrie Cahill and Thomas Murphy from Free State of Jones. There's a video chat with the writer and director of the original Sharknado discussing that phenomena. And then of course, there's food and drink. There's going to be a food demo of mock shark fin soup, because you know that is really not cool. And their chef James Cullen's going to discuss the history and the controversy behind that soup, do a demonstration. Todd Price is going to be there from the Times-Picayune. That's going to be great. Then, you know, just when you're thinking about eating the sharks, they're going to come in with the Audubon Institute and tell us why sharks matter. There's going to be a cocktail demo, a cocktail called the Shark Attack with Danielle Victory. Then there's going to be another food demo. I guess it'll be ceviche with shark. I don't know, but they're making ceviche. There's going to be arts and crafts available with the crew of Sharknado. Of course, that's D-E-A-U-X. This is going to be a crazy all-day thing, and don't worry, I know there'll be plenty of pizza, too, from Pizza Nola, so.
There's screenings, too. They're doing movies,
too. Everything's going to, it's incredible, all day long. And then, if you haven't visited the Dryades Public Market yet, it is such a fabulous space, and Chef Levi Rains of Compare Le Pen is going to be doing a little pop-up event sort of dinner there, the Central City Supper Club, and that's Thursday coming up. It's only $65 for an incredible
menu.
That's
a good deal.
It is. The amuse-bouche is Stellar Bay oysters with tomato creme fraiche. Then there's going to be a marinated flounder with a tomatillo granita. Mmm, talk about frozen. That sounds good. Pork dumplings with creamed arugula, Korean short ribs with a scallion kimchi, and for dessert, sponge cake with grilled peaches and coriander. It's going to be delicious. It's a beautiful space. I think it's going to be a really fun time. Only $65 on Thursday. And then on Friday, there's going to be at Grand Isle, and all I can say is, if you haven't been to Grand Isle since Chef Ryan Hegler took over, you are missing out, because he's doing incredible food, and they are actually going to the James Beard House to do a dinner, and so they're doing a preview, and it too is only $65, and his sous chef Spencer Minch and Chef Jacob Curitan, who is from Annunciation, are going to be participating. Hot swamp chicken and Creole tomato pie with blue crab and pimento cheese. There's a mouthful of Julia's words. Sea ham and land ham. That's interesting. It's cobia and pig with Creole cream cheese and Steen's cane syrup and yum. She crab soup with a crispy soft shell crab. Here's something that sounds great. Open-faced hot duck sausage rich boy. Not poor boy. With seared foie gras. And then dessert is really grand. Brulo service with moon pies, Charleston chews, and coconut cake. And there's also wine and cocktail pairings available. And I'm telling you, you can just eat good and party all week long.
Thank you so much, Bobby. And now it's time for our artist spotlight. Tonight we are featuring Louisiana artist Carol Halleck. And the first work of art that we wanted to show you is called Geraldine II. Halleck is frequently inspired by the natural surroundings of her home in Lacombe. This is Clouds in the Way. Her work is included along with the work of 30 other artists in Hot Art in a Cool Space at North Shore Unitarian Universalists in Lacombe, where a Meet the Artist reception will take place tomorrow evening. And now, Augustin. Yes, okay. Tennessee Williams lives year-round these days. I know, we are involved with the Tennessee Williams Festival, but you're doing this and kicking off a season of Tennessee Williams with the Rose Tattoo.
That's right.
How did you all decide, a group of you all, get together to do Tennessee Williams all the time?
So long story short, when I was in college, I just hated Tennessee Williams. As we were just saying, I'm from the Mississippi Delta. I got beat over the head with Tennessee Williams this and Tennessee Williams that. But we had I had a teacher in college who just really turned my whole world upside down when she said, well, maybe look at Tennessee Williams this way. And so I fell head over heels in love with Tennessee Williams. And so ever since then, I couldn't stop reading the plays and couldn't stop going to see the plays, wanting to do the plays. And so fast forward a few years later, I meet Nick Shackelford, my now co-artistic director of the Tennessee Williams Theater Company of New Orleans, and I helped to introduce him to Tennessee Williams. And it's everything for him, too. This is our second season. So we decide to put together a company that does all Tennessee Williams all the time. Of course, New Orleans is the perfect home for a theater company focusing on Tennessee Williams. It's a spiritual home. We think Tennessee Williams, we think Streetcar Named Desire, suddenly last summer, all these rich New Orleans plays. And so we begin doing Tennessee Williams all the time.
So you're doing his comedy.
We are. The Rose Tattoo is our first, I would say, big comedy. It's a large cast. It's a spectacle of a show. It's really funny. It's not what you expect from Tennessee Williams, where it's all faded Southern bells and things like that. We're really trying to show a different side to Tennessee Williams. If you haven't seen The Rose Tattoo before, it's raucous. It's bacchanalian. There's everything in the kitchen sink included, thrown into this play. Goats, children, truck drivers. It's all sorts of things.
Now, in the movie, it was Anna Magnani and Burt Lancaster, wasn't it? Yeah. So your actress is a lot younger and prettier than Anna Magnani.
That's true.
And we'll show her in just a little bit, too.
Right.
But was it hard to cast?
You know, it was so easy to cast. It's fascinating. We did the math, and Serafina in the play says that she was a bride of 14. And their daughter is 15 or 17 years old. So she really hovers close around 30. The fascinating fact about it was that Anna Magnani, the play was written for her, but she was too nervous about learning to speak enough English to do it on stage. So Maureen Stapleton replaced her in the stage production, but she finally got a chance, Anna Magnani,
kind of
to do a turn.
Kind of earthy and lusty and that sort of thing.
Yeah. So she finally got a chance to do it in the film with Burt Lancaster. So that was the first time Anna Magnani got a hold of it, but it was a few years after it was written.
I see. Well, now I think it's time that we're going to show Lillian J. Small as Serafina and Mike Spera as Mangiacavallo from The Rose Tattoo.
Lady, I gotta go in the house.
What are you doing in my house? Why have you come here? Why have you come in my house?
Leave me alone now, please.
You got no business in here.
I gotta cry after a fight.
What's the matter with you?
I always cry after a fight, but I don't want anybody to see me. It's not like a man.
A man is not no different than nobody else. Oh, I always cry when someone else is crying.
No, lady, don't you cry. I will stop. No, lady, please, don't you cry. This is not like a man. I am ashamed. I will stop now. Please, I am ashamed. I will stop now.
Your jacket is torn.
My company jacket is torn.
Down the back.
Where is it torn?
Give it to me. I will sew for you. I do sewing.
He said he would fire me if I don't stop fighting.
Give me the jacket.
He took down my license number.
Oh, people are always taking down license numbers and telephone numbers and numbers that don't mean nothing. All them numbers.
He said he would fire me if I don't stop fighting.
I just wanted to cry all day.
He said he would fire me if I don't stop fighting.
Ah, stop crying so I can stop crying.
I am a sissy. Excuse me. I am ashamed.
Don't be ashamed of nothing. This world is too crazy for people to be ashamed in. I'm not ashamed, and I got into two fights on the street, and my daughter called me disgusting. I gotta sew this by hand because the machine is broke from a fight with two women.
That's what they call a cat fight.
Open the shutters, please, for me. I can't see to work.
What, lady?
The light on the body was like a man that lived here.
Che dice?
Fa niente. Come strano. Lei napoletano?
Io sono siciliano.
Ah!
Che fa?
I stuck myself with the needle. You better go wash up.
Dove è il gabinetto?
Dietro.
Con permesso. A kick like that can have serious consequences.
Oh. Oh, Madonna Santa, my husband's body with the head of a clown. Oh, lady, speak to me. What are you saying? I can't hear you. Is it a sign? Is it a sign of something? Speak to me, lady. Everything is too strange.
Ciao.
Once again, the Rose Tattoo runs through next weekend at the Samuel Dubois Cook Theater on Dillard's campus and Gentilly Boulevard. So excited. And now time for our picks. Julia, pick.
Last night I had this amazing slushy Negroni at Bellini Tavern on Magazine Street. I mean, a Negroni is a great thing. A slushy Negroni in New Orleans in July is an even greater thing.
Absolutely. Poppy.
Well, who would think next Friday is National Oyster Day? So celebrate the event at Trinity Restaurant, where they have five different kinds of oyster dishes. My favorite is the panko crusted broiled with cayenne aioli and flying fish roe.
Wow.
Really good.
Augustin.
I'm going to say Big River at Tulane yes. Summer Lyric. I love theater. I'm not going to get to see it because of the Rose Tattoo, but I'm looking forward to hearing all about it.
Right. Marci.
I'm going to say Satchmo Summerfest. this year in Jackson Square, Muriel's is joining us, serving their famous shrimp and goat cheese crepes. So come hear some great traditional jazz and eat well and drink well.
Very good. And now my picks, the Nola Nixettes dance troupe, part of the crew of Nix, will hold tryouts, that's tomorrow, at the North Lions Recreational Center, right there on Louisiana and Chapultepec. Visit the website to register. And one of our favorite singers, pianist, Michael J. O'Hara, performs with his band Resurrection at the Tap Room in Covington. That's tomorrow night. Since Alan is out of town this week, I wanted to give a shout out to the New Orleans Shakespeare Festival at Tulane's production of The Illusion. Not Shakespeare, but this free adaptation of 17th century playwright's Corneille's work by Tony Kushner evokes a kindred spirit to the bard, pondering themes of love and betrayal, well worth a visit to the Lupin Theater. And that is through next Saturday, August the 6th. Directed by Chaney Tullis, and you've just seen Silas Cooper and Christine McMurdo Wallace, part of a fine cast. And don't forget the arts market, that's tomorrow from 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. at Palmer Park. Thank you all so very much.
Thank you.
And thank you for watching. Good night.